Okay, I wanted to talk about the advanced features of this device, right? So if we go into the settings, you can see we've got the name, the about, the lock screen, which I will demonstrate here in a second, sounds, change pin, pretty standard. And then I had not realized there was this little arrow here, which takes you to the second screen of features or settings, right? Bluetooth, I get. They have NFC. Now, this is not enabled yet. And I went and read a little bit more about this. So far, the only thing that the NFC supports is a ledger technology for two-factor authentication and using this device as a two-factor. I'm not a huge fan of using my ledger device as a two-factor. Like a hardware two-factor, because it's just too inconvenient for that. Hardware two-factor should be, okay, you need to authorize, you touch it, or you put it in the USB port or whatever, and, it works, right? But with a ledger device, you've got to pull it out, you've got to connect it, wake it up, enter the PIN. It's just too inconvenient to function seamlessly as a two-factor authentication device, but we'll see. But so far, that's the only thing that the NFC is good for, and it's not even done yet. But conceivably, this could work like the Tandem card, but better because it has a screen. So the Tandem card, if you're not aware, it looks like a credit card. I love the Tandem card, but when you authorize transactions, you do have to use the NFC technology by holding it close to your phone, but you have no confirmation screen on the device. So in a way, you sort of, the device requires a bit of trust. Any hardware wallet requires trust. Let's get that out of the way. That's sorry to break that to you guys, but every crypto hardware wallet out there requires some level of trust. And people attack Ledger because, oh, I don't trust it. Well, every single hardware wallet on the market requires a certain level of trust in the company. Because it's never completely open source or transparent. That's just the nature of the device. It lives in the real world. It's not mathematically perfect. So anyway, I'll get off that soapbox. So they have NFC technology in this guy. Pretty cool. Let's see here. We can launch a QR code that'll help us launch Ledger Live. The battery settings are here. You've got a manual reset if you want to wipe the device. And I have wiped this device two or three times already. Seems to work just fine. I set it up, I wiped it, I restored it, I wiped it again, I restored it again, and then today I wiped it and restored it and synced it up to my go-to Ledger Nano X. So that seems to work just fine. Have any trouble with that. The advanced feature is where you access the passphrase functionality. And someone had asked me, in the comments of my review, does it have passphrase functionality? And I couldn't find it until I realized that it was on the second screen of settings, kind of tucked away inside this advanced setting. So you have the option of setting a passphrase, just like you do with the Ledger Nano X. And I would assume it would be a lot less difficult than doing it on the Ledger Nano X. One of the problems with using the Ledger Nano X and with a passphrase is you only have those two buttons for entering numbers and symbols and letters. And it's really a difficult interface to master. But being able to use their little on-screen keypad for entering your passphrase is really a game changer for this device. So one of the greatest things about this touchscreen is improving the passphrase management, right? It'll be so much easier to enter a passphrase on the device than it was on the previous Ledger devices. So pretty cool stuff. Also, I wanted to demonstrate, we can go back here, that this thing does have wireless charging. So you can drop it and it'll start charging. Yeah, you can see here that it is charging. This is an Apple phone charger. I'm not sure how many different chargers it's compatible with. I thought that this Apple charger was kind of proprietary just for Apple, but it looks like the Ledger Stacks can take advantage of that. Now, I also know that the Ledger Stacks has a magnet, but it's not strong enough to hold. Okay. So it does hold it up. I have a stand that I use for my phone, and I couldn't get the Ledger Stacks to stay stuck to that, but it seems to be doing a pretty good job here. So maybe I should try that again. So yeah, so it's got the wireless charging. That's pretty cool. Okay, so I'm going to go over to the other screen, and I talked about NFC, passphrase, and charging. And so let's get to setting the screen. Turns out it's in the My Ledger section. So in the My Ledger section, it connects to the device. You say allow. All right, that's all well and good. And it's here. Lock screen picture. And I had looked in here a couple of times and just missed it. So that's where you go to change the lock screen picture. And we're at OS 1.4. They're calling it OS. They're not calling it firmware. They're calling it OS. And when I first took this out of the box, so there were some updates that I had to go through in that first look. You can check out how that works. Pretty straightforward. You just connect it, do the genuine check, and you know, it'll ask you to run the updates. So yeah, that's the current version right now. Let's see what else we got. Oh, let's go ahead and change this. So you can use an NFT. So if you click NFT, it sort of scans your device for any NFTs that you may have in your Ethereum wallets. Maybe in the Polygon wallets too, I'm not sure. So pretty cool stuff. But let's go ahead and change that picture. We can upload it from the computer. This is the picture of my lovely wife. I thought, okay, there it is. Okay, there we go. And so, you know, you can change it around a little bit if you want. Not much leeway with it. We'll hit confirm crop. And then confirm that we can make it darker if we want. But I like the default. Works just fine. All right. And then the device is going to ask you to load the picture. And there it goes. And there we go. We got that lock screen picture. And it's really cool because it'll just sit there forever. Apparently, a lock screen, the e-ink technology requires no power once it is like been, you know, once it is written to the screen, it doesn't require any power. So it just kind of, that lock screen just hangs out for a while. It's pretty cool. So there, that's, and you know, we could do more, we can change it, you know, we can pull up any picture from our computer or any NFT that's in any of the existing Ethereum wallets. I didn't notice that, it's possible that it might work with Polygon NFTs as well, right? And of course, they're only going to be displayed in grayscale. It's too bad for that. So what else was I going to do here? I get too excited. The capacity, right. All right. So the capacity of the Ledger Stacks is only 1.09 megabytes. And the capacity of the Ledger Nano X is 1.76 megabytes. Seems rather small, and it is, right? But it's will hold quite a few apps. I mean, I've got the major apps on there now. I've got Solana, Bitcoin, Ethereum, Monero, and Cosmos on here now. And of course, you know, there have been, if you look at my Ledger Nano X, it's practically full because I've had a lot of other crypto apps on there in the past. And so it's definitely, I would have to, you know, migrating over, you know, we're seeing a lot less room on the Ledger stacks. I don't know what the excuse for that is. I really couldn't say why they would come out with like a new flagship product with all these great features and this great screen and couldn't figure out how to, you know, give it at least the same amount of storage as a Ledger Nano X, if not more. I mean, why couldn't they put 2 megabytes on there or 3 or 4 or 5? You know, it just a lot of people in the comments of my review were pretty upset about its capacity. So, and of course, you know, the whole idea behind the stacks is that you will have more than one, so you can stack them, right? That's the, you know, if you look at the Ledger Stacks page. So, and with the idea being that you would have more than one of these for different types of crypto or different self-custody scenarios, so to speak. And I'm all behind that. I'm all behind, you know, having a go-to, you know, deep storage wallet for your, you know, your go-to long-term holding, and then a different hardware wallet for doing DeFi with only, you know, just enough amounts of Ethereum or Solana or Polygon in there for your fees, right? You don't want to connect a wallet that's got 10 Ethereum in it to a DEX, right? Unless you're trying to trade for something that requires that amount, you really don't want to expose your long-term storage to Web3. So I'm all for not putting all your eggs in one basket and spreading out your crypto assets. And then they had one where, let's see. Right, so we've got Noah's Crypto, we've got My Mint Bag, we've got the Family Backup. So I get that, right? I get that, you know, you want to have a device that sort of advocates that you don't want everything in one device. I get that totally. But I don't know if that's a good excuse for making a device that only has 1 megabyte's worth of app storage on there. Right. I don't quite understand that, but I love I love the idea of spreading your crypto across different hardware devices. I get that. I'd be more of an advocate of different wallets from different manufacturers for different use cases. Right. Like I have a Tangem. I have a Trezor. You know, I have all kinds of different crypto wallets, and you may, you know, have preferences, you know, for security and ease of use. And so, yeah, I mean, it's okay to have more than, you know, it's good practice to have more than one device. And if you're like a big fan of the stacks and you think stacks is the way to go, and have more than one is great also, but it's a little pricey, you know, to sort of sell that to people, you know, for $269 a pop. You know, if we're talking about a $79 device or even a $150 device, I could see the use case for, hey, you should have more than one, you know, blah, blah, blah. And the whole argument, you know, okay, I got, you know, I've got $50,000 worth of crypto, or I have $100,000 worth of crypto. Of course, you know, you can afford to buy 4 or 5 Ledger stacks, right? You know, you're protecting thousands and thousands of dollars worth of crypto, so it makes sense to do it sensibly. I get all that, but the normal, you know, end user is going to find it hard to swallow the fact that they should go out and buy 3 or 4 Ledger stacks at $269 a pop. That's kind of my thing there.